Good morning. Welcome to worship. Let's all stand together. You know, what a blessing it is to know the love of Christ, to know that our sins are forgiven, to know that our names are written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. I call you to worship this morning. Let's lift our voices in adoration for Christ, for all that he's done for us. This is my story. This is my song. Praise my Savior all day.
Be seated. I love that song. And I started just thinking as I was singing that, I'm sorry you had to listen to that, Brother Ron, but to think about how I got here. It's only Jesus. It's only Jesus. If it wasn't for his grace, none of us would be here, amen? So I hope that for you, looking back on your life, you can see the fingerprint of God and his faithfulness. And that you can simply say, just like we sang, oh, to tell you my story is to tell of him. Yeah. Church, we're glad that you're here. We want to say welcome to all of our guests here on campus and then also everyone that's watching online. And we would just love to be able to connect with you. So maybe you're here or you're watching online this morning and you'd like to know more about our church, or God's already stirring in your heart and you'd like to talk to somebody about salvation, or you just need prayer. And the best way to connect with us this morning is to simply send us a text to 474747. Just send the word Pisgah to that number and you'll receive an automatic message where you can click a link and give us a little bit of your information, and one of our pastors will reach out to you soon. And if you're here on this campus this morning as a guest, we would love for you to drop by one of our welcome centers and just fill out a little card and we'll reach out to you as soon as we can. But this morning, before we continue to worship in song, we want to welcome Dr. Ron Lynch. He's going to be bringing the word this morning, and I know that you've made a huge impact on my life, just like Pastor Chad, so we want to say welcome. And then we also want to just remind you, Grow Groups will be back on campus next Sunday, and with that, I just say hallelujah, amen. All right, a little bit, yeah, that's good. We're thankful that we're kind of getting back to normal, and then I also want to remind you that in our welcome centers, there's a little 21-day prayer plan leading up to D-Now. That starts this Friday, and we would love for all of you to go and grab one of those cards and just to join us in prayer. See, we can prepare for a great weekend. We can have all the details ironed out, but without prayer, there's no power. And so I ask if you guys would just stop by one of our welcome centers. You can see a small card and just join us in prayer starting this Friday over the next few weeks. But church, let's just think about Jesus. Let's worship him this morning in spirit and in truth. And before we continue to sing, I want to ask if you would join me in prayer. Father, thank you so much for your grace. Thank you so much for your faithfulness. And I'm reminded of what David said, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." God, in you there is salvation, in you there is satisfaction. And I pray that this morning we won't rely on some sort of image we've made up in our head, but God, we would rely on your word and what you've revealed about your son Jesus and yourself, and we would respond to that truth this morning in worship. God, meet with us today, and I pray that you would save folks in Jesus' name, amen.
Would you please stand with us?
Praise the Lord.
was the pain, his life was the cost. We stood neath the debt we could never afford. Oh, but praise God,
our sins, they are.
But thank God that that mercy bought me the right to be the child of God. Amen. And I am a child of God. Praise the Lord.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me?
Right here.
I was lost, but he brought me in on his love for me. On his love.
Hallelujah.
my Father's house, there's a place for me. He said, I go to prepare for you a place. And if I go to prepare for you a place, I'll come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, ye may be also. I pray today that you know that when he returns, your name has been written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and that you are a child of the King. If you're not today, I pray that the Lord would, as Ron said in the first service, help you to realize that you're lost, because he came to seek and to save that which was lost. You can't get saved until you get lost. And when you understand that Jesus is the only way to salvation, business is about to pick up in your life. I am so glad that you've joined us today for a wonderful day of worship. I am grateful to have Brother Ron here. I appreciate his investment in my life and in my ministry. And I'm always excited when he gets a chance to come and be with us. Church, I want to say again to you, thank you so much for your faithfulness in giving. You guys have been absolutely wonderful. And I know we took up a large offering on the fifth Sunday in January. And I'm excited to report to the church today that this week we were able to make a payment on the principal portion of our loan on this building of $500,000. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Go ahead. He's good. Hey, we're not a bank. We don't hang on to it around here. We try to get that debt paid off. Amen. And I pray that in the coming days, we'd get the debt taken care of on this building. You say, well, how much was it? I'm not scared to tell you. We owed 1.8 on this building. As of this week, we now owe 1.3 on this building. And so we praise the Lord for that. And we hope that in the next few months that we can get this building taken care of, because we got greater things we want to talk to you about in the days ahead. You just keep praying. Amen. So as you leave this morning, our offering plates are at the back, and you come, and if you came prepared to give, you can do so as you exit this morning. And then also, Brother Ron with us, he was sharing with me that in COVID days, he is preaching about 1/5 the number of meetings that he normally preaches. Churches just really aren't having a lot of revivals right now, and I want us, as you leave this morning, if you've come, just to be generous to him. There's a basket back there. The guys will be holding a basket. The offering plate will be for your tithe and offering. The basket will be for the love gift that you can give Brother Ron on your way out. And he's also blessed us this morning with a USB drive that's got about 70 sermons on it. If you're a real student of the Word of God and you love the Word of God, I'd invite you to grab one of these on your way out. Miss Judy, his wife, will be at the table. And then he's got a book written by Warren Wiersbe that'll teach you how to study the Bible. People ask me all the time, Pastor, where do I start? How do I get started studying the Bible? Well, Warren Wiersbe has put together a great book, easy to understand, easy to comprehend this, of how to do an effective Bible study. And so he's got these available for you back there. And if you don't have the money to buy it, he'll just give them to you, all right? He's talking. He ain't listening to me. Amen, brother. Amen. So you saw the thumbs up, all right? So get them all.
That's a policy I have. Anybody that wants something, don't have the money.
He said that's his policy. If you want something of his and you don't have any money, just take it. I know he means that, but he does have to eat this afternoon too, all right? Church, thank you so much for being here. You're going to hear a message in just a minute out of Psalm 45 about here comes the King Bridegroom. Church, Jesus is coming. The next prophetic event on God's timetable is the rapture of the church. And we're getting out of here. We're going to go be with him. There'll be the marriage supper of the Lamb. I don't want to preach a sermon, but then we're coming back. And we're coming back with him. And he's going to rule and reign. And Jeremy and the praise team is going to lead us in a song, Here He Comes. And church, let's celebrate while they sing that he is coming. Heavenly Father, thank you for how we've already, Lord, sensed the tangible felt presence of the Holy Spirit in this place today. And now, God, I pray you'd encourage us as we sing about your soon return. And Lord, I pray if there be anybody here this morning that doesn't know you, they would come to know you as Lord and Savior today. Touch from on high in Jesus' name. Amen. And you may be seated.
for his return today. Put your hands together.
Here it comes, stepping down from glory. Bethlehem is just the start of the story. Here he comes. Oh, here he comes. Here he comes, teaching in the temple, making timeless wisdom sound simple. Here he comes. Oh, here he comes. Here he comes to seek and save.
Jeremy, you got the great music as always. I love this church. I love to hear praising God, don't you?
Amen.
And old brother Danny over here looks like he's going to have a fit all the time. Amen. God has just want us to realize that celebration here is just a foretaste of celebration over there. To see him as he is, and to know that one day we will be just like him. Thank you, Pastor, for the opportunity of being here today. I hope you have your Bible. Let's look together in Psalm 45. Psalm 45. As you turn there, I want to remind you of a few things. This is what we call in Scripture a messianic psalm. You say, now, what do you mean messianic psalm? Well, there's psalms of repentance. There's seven of those. There's psalms of lament. There's different psalms that we categorize from this hymn book. You realize this is a hymn book. These are songs, worship songs, that we praise God, and we need to know the context. Now, this is a messianic psalm. If you're interested in studying these, there's many of them. For instance, Psalm 2. Psalm 8, Psalm 22, Psalm 24, Psalm 110, Psalm 91. And this one in particular, Psalm 45. Now, what qualifies a messianic psalm? It is a psalm that is quoted in the New Testament. And it's always in reference to Jesus. Now, what's the most quoted messianic psalm? By far, Psalm 110. One verse, verse 1 in Psalm 110, is either quoted or implied 25 times in the New Testament. My son's a pastor in Alabama. He pastored a church here in North Carolina, and one of his deacons said to him in a deacon's meeting, "You need to quit preaching out of the Old Testament." Said, "Do you not realize, young man, that the New Testament is what's written to us, not the Old Testament?" And my son just kind of just shook his head. "Do you not realize, any of you, that most of the New Testament is quotations from the Old Testament?" Someone has said it this way: the Old Testament is the New Testament concealed. The New Testament is the Old Testament revealed. This is a Jesus book. Now, would you stand with me for the reading of God's Word, beginning at verse 1 here of Psalm 45. I've entitled my sermon, "Here Comes the King Bridegroom." So you find both the bridegroom in this text and a king. "My heart is inditing a good matter. I speak of things which I have made touching the king. My tongue is the pen of a ready writer. Thou art fairer than the children of men. Grace is poured into thy lips. Therefore God hath blessed thee forever. Gird thy sword upon thy thigh, O most mighty, with thy glory and thy majesty. And in thy majesty ride prosperously because of truth and meekness and righteousness. And thy right hand shall teach thee terrible things. Thine arrows are sharp in the heart of the king's enemies, whereby the people fall under thee." Now, underline verses 6 and 7. These particular verses are quoted in Hebrews 1, 8, and 9. In Hebrews 1, 8, and 9, the discussion is that Jesus is greater than angels. And so you'll find this quotation concerning Jesus in Hebrews. Here it is: "Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of thy kingdom is a right scepter. Thou lovest righteousness and hatest wickedness. Therefore God, thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows. All thy garments smell of myrrh, aloes, and cassia. And out of the ivory palaces, whereby they have made thee glad." Now the discussion changes in verse 9. Verses 1 through 8 is the bridegroom. Now we're going to be speaking of the bride. I'm only going to use one point out of this text. Look at what it says in verse number 9. "King's daughters were among thy honorable women." That's just saying that at this wedding scene, there's going to be a court. The bride has a court. "Upon thy right hand did stand the queen in gold of Ophrah. Hearken, O daughter," now this is the bride, "and consider, incline thine ear, forget not thine, and forget also thine own people and thy father's house. So shall the king greatly desire thy beauty, for he is thy Lord. And worship thou him." Father, we thank you for your word. I pray that, God, you'd get me out of the way. And only Christ and Christ alone would be heard and seen in this place. Just for Jesus' sake, amen. I want to preach this morning concerning here comes the bridegroom. You do understand that once you become a believer in Jesus Christ, according to Ephesians 1, 13 and 14, God gives you an engagement ring. There's symbolic language used of the Holy Spirit in Ephesians 1, 13 and 14. The language that's used is this: God purchased you as property, made a down payment on the property, and said that you're his. So it's what we call earnest money. But then there's also this picture in Ephesians 1, 13 and 14 of God giving us an engagement ring. Now, for those who were espoused or betrothed in New Testament times and even today in the Middle East, the engagement is like a binding contract. That's why Joseph could have set aside Mary and not married her, even though he had been engaged to her once he found out that she was with child. Their matter of marriage is much different than our thinking. When we get married, we think we're married. When they got engaged, they were legally in an agreement. So they were engaged, and we are engaged. You say, how do you know you're engaged to Jesus? The Holy Spirit is the engagement ring that wears me. I don't wear him. He wears me. He's been wearing me out ever since I've been saved. He lives inside of me, and he lets me know that I'm as good as already married. Now, when the Lord comes, we will experience the marriage supper of the Lamb. Where's that described? Revelation 19, verses 6 through 8. And so there is this marriage ceremony that will take place in eternity, and then here on earth, we're going on a honeymoon with Jesus for at least 1,000 years. You say, well, who wrote this particular psalm? Well, there's much debate about it. Some would say that this psalm was written by Solomon. How do we know? Because Solomon married a king's daughter, or Pharaoh's daughter, in 1 Kings 3. And so some believe that this is a typology in type of Solomon, fulfilled ultimately by Jesus when Solomon chose Pharaoh's daughter to be his wife. Now, some believe, and this is a popular belief, that this was written by someone else, and they think it was written concerning Hezekiah and Hezekiah marrying a woman by the name of Hephzibah. Hephzibah, it is believed that she was Isaiah's daughter. So some think that Isaiah may have written this particular psalm. Now, ultimately, here's what we know. This psalm was written by the Holy Spirit. I like what Spurgeon has said in his commentary. Spurgeon says, some see in this psalm only Solomon. They are short-sighted. Some see Solomon and Christ. They're cross-eyed. He said, if you see 2020 and you see correctly, you only see Jesus. Why? Because Solomon may be in the shadow. But Jesus here is the one that we're married to. And we look forward to that day that we will be ultimately connected to Jesus in a different frame of mind. You say, well, how do we walk today? Here's a verse that you need to hang on your hat. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 8 says, whom having not seen, you love. I've never seen Jesus. Now, some of you have seen pictures of Jesus that came out of the dark ages, that it's been propagated by the Catholic Church, and you may have one of those in your house, and you may have pictures of Jesus. You be careful, because you don't know what Jesus looked like physically. And so a lot of people think, well, that is something that artists have come up with, and they have, and that it is symbolic. But let me say this to you. Every one of us who have the Holy Spirit in us, we've been enlightened in our inner man, and we have a understanding from Scripture. And Scripture only by the Spirit, who the Lord Jesus Christ really, really is. Now, listen, these weddings are very expensive. Did you know the average wedding in America? I asked my wife, I said, what do you think the average wedding is? She said, well, at least 10 grand. I never have understood this. I had three girls. Why does the father of the daughter had to pay for everything? You say, well, that's just tradition. That's exactly what it is. So the average wedding in America is not 10 grand. The average wedding in America is 27 grand. When Prince William was married to Kate, he paid 34 million. You'll find that when Prince Charles was married to Prince D, he paid 45 million. It's estimated that if that wedding took place today, it would be $100 million. You say, well, our wedding is not expensive. Our wedding is far more expensive than $100 million. You say, well, preacher, what paid for our wedding? I was not paid for with silver and gold. I was purchased by the royal red blood of Christ. And Christ has purchased me freely and fully, and it was expensive for him to marry me because he shed his blood on Calvary's cross that my sins could be forgiven. Now, as we think about this marriage and being with Jesus, I have five simple points from this text. I could really preach a long time from this text, but I'm going to try just to keep it to the norm. Amen? I want you to see, first of all, what I would call in this marriage ceremony and meeting Christ, I want you to notice the character of our King Bridegroom. What is the character of the King Bridegroom? It's described in verse number 2. In verses 3 through 5, we see the conquest of our King Bridegroom. In verses 6 and 7, we see the crown of our King Bridegroom. And then in verse 8, we see the clothing of our King Bridegroom. And then in verses 9, 10, and 11, we'll look at the church of the King Bridegroom, which is us, the bride. First of all, let's notice in this text the character. Now, in verse number 2, it reads this way, "Thou art fairer." Now, we know that's not speaking of his physical appearance. Why? Because Isaiah 53 says that Jesus Christ's physical appearance is not something that is that attractive. I know you think it is, but it was not. And the Bible makes it pretty clear that what he's speaking of, I believe here, is his moral glory. So we see this text, it says he's fairer. And then it says in that same verse that he has words that are full of grace. And then it says that he's been blessed forever. So as we look at Jesus this morning, we see three things about him and his character in verse number 2. First of all, we see his sinlessness. Now, I have a hard time saying all that, but what do you mean sinlessness? That word fairer can be better translated like this, "Thou art beautiful." And in the Hebrew, it reads this way, "Thou art beautiful, beautiful." It's repeated. Now, what's beautiful about Jesus? What's beautiful about Jesus is he was a man, but he never sinned. You say, well, could he have sinned? No, we believe in the doctrine of impeccability. You say, what does the doctrine of impeccability mean? It means that Jesus not only did not sin, but Jesus could not sin. You say, why do you believe, preacher, Jesus could not have sinned? If he was tempted in all points as we are, yet without sin, it would not be a real temptation unless Jesus could have sinned. Well, if Jesus could have sinned, he would have ceased to be God. But he can't cease to be God because he's 100% God as if he's not man. Well, if he's tempted as man and not as God, being 100% man as if he's not God, even though he's 100% God as if he's not man, how can he be tempted as man and not be able to sin? Because he's 100% God. Amen? And so you need to get your mind wrapped around who Jesus Christ really is. He is the God-man, but he was tempted as man, yet without sin. He never, ever had a bad day. He never worried about anything. Not anything gets on his nerves. He is beautiful in his sovereignty. He's beautiful in his wisdom. He's beautiful in his character. He's beautiful in his perfection. He is the one who did not sin. Where do you find that? 1 Peter 2:22 says he's without guile and without sin. Let me give you another one. 1 John 3:5 says that Jesus Christ was made sin for us who knew no sin. He is the lamb that it was caught in, put up for us without blemish. There is nothing about Jesus that is not perfect in his sinlessness. And the reason he must be sinless is because you're sinful. You're wicked to the core. You say, preacher, I'm not so bad. Oh, yes, you are. And the best you deserve is hell, and you should burn for eternity. But God sent somebody who was sinless to take care of you who were sinful. And so therefore, Jesus Christ is sinless. He's perfect. Now, you'll never see that unless the Holy Spirit shows you that. Because when you come under Holy Spirit conviction, you'll see that you're so sinful and you've offended God, but yet Jesus Christ is perfect and Jesus Christ is sinless. Not only do you see in this text, in his character, his sinlessness, but notice his graciousness. The word grace is only used twice in the Psalms. The other place that grace is used is Psalm 84, verse 11. Now look at the word grace there in verse 2. The Bible says that in verse 2 that grace is poured into thy lips. Now some translate it this way. He always spoke with graciousness. Now the Bible teaches us that this is true about Jesus. Where do you find it? Well, you find it in Luke 4:22. Here's what it says. They marveled at the gracious words that proceeded out of his mouth. They even said in John 7:46, never a man spake like this man. There is nobody like Jesus Christ. But you say, well, preacher, he always had a kind word. Well, ask the Pharisees. Read Matthew 23, where Jesus took a knife and split them wide open. Ask the false teachers. Jesus said to them, you're a bunch of vipers, snakes in the grass. I never will forget being at the convention, and W.A. Criswell preached in Dallas, Texas, when we were having quite a struggle as Southern Baptists, and we're having somewhat the same fights and struggles. You say, why would we have another fight as Southern Baptists? Well, we're always defending the truth. And W.A. Criswell, in that day, he said, some people say that we have people in our convention and preachers that are moderates. He says, they're not moderates, they're liberals. He said, you can call a skunk whatever you want to call a skunk, but he's still a skunk. Well, that made all the liberals upset. The headlines were, W.A. Criswell calls the liberals skunks. Well, they're worse than that. You say, preacher, wait a minute. Jesus Christ always speaks words of graciousness, but sometimes his gracious words to you may seem unkind. But I want to tell you, he speaks gracious words to you this morning if you're lost. He says to you, I love you with an everlasting love. I loved you enough that I died on the cross for your sins. not only his sinlessness, but his graciousness. But then notice in verse 2, his blessedness. God the Father hath blessed him forever. Now, how'd God the Father bless him forever? I like what Flanagan says in his study of this, in his commentary. Flanagan says that God didn't bless him because of who he is. God blessed him because the Father lived his life in his Son. Here's the miracle that many of you don't understand. Jesus Christ did not live the Christian life. He said he didn't. In John 5, 29 and 30, Jesus said, I can do nothing without the... Jesus said, the words that I speak are not my words, but whose? Jesus said, the works that I do are not my works, but whose? In the upper room, one of the disciples asked this question, show us the Father. He said, have I been with you so long that you've not seen him in me? He and I are one. So when the Father looked down at his Son several times and said, hey, that's my boy. That's my beloved Son. And I'm pleased with him. Was he pleased with him because Jesus lived the Christian life? Or was he pleased with him because Jesus, as man, let the Father, by the Spirit, live his life through him? Well, when Jesus looks at you, in John 15, what he said, without me you can do. And Jesus said, the life that you now will live will not be your life, but whose? I'm the vine, you're the branch. Abide in me, and I'll abide in you. In this marriage that we have a bridegroom that is beautiful. The emphasis on who's beautiful at this wedding ceremony is not the bride. It's the bridegroom. Today's Valentine's Day. I'm sure some of you, you think back. Maybe your spouse has gone on. Maybe you're celibate and you've never been married. Maybe you are married and you've been married for a while. But maybe some of you, not very long. It ought to get sweeter. You ought to be more in love right now than you've ever been. And I find Jesus to be more beautiful today. Than he was when I first met him. Because Ray, I know him a little bit better. There is the character. Notice, secondly, with me, his conquest. Now, he comes to this wedding. Look at verse number 3. He's got a sword in his hand. Boy, isn't that something? Now, I'm packing these days, not right now, but but you never know, amen? And so I have my permit, and I'm used to packing. Some churches I go to, I put one in my pocket, but anyway, You never know what you're going to meet up with. But Jesus Christ is carrying a sword. Gird his thigh with a sword. Look what it says. His name, look how he's referred to. He's called Mighty. That takes us back to Isaiah 9, verse 6, where he's called the Mighty God. You find that Jesus Christ is not going to run from a fight. You say, well, when did Jesus Christ ever look for a fight? Jesus looked for a fight when he came to the earth. Who was he looking for a fight with? Read Ezekiel 28, Isaiah 14. Jesus Christ is out to get Satan. The Bible says in 1 John 3:8 that one of the reasons he came to the earth is to destroy the works of Satan. Before you were a child of God, you were a child of Satan. Before you were a child of light, you were a child of darkness. But Jesus came down here.
Amen.
And he took Satan on. And he was tempted by Satan, but he overcame Satan. He was tempted with lust of the eye, lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. Adam and Eve gave in to those temptations, but Jesus Christ did not. And Jesus Christ defeated Satan at Calvary's cross. He defeated Satan when he was raised from the dead. And Jesus Christ has come to set the captive free. Now, this reference also is a reference to when the Lord Jesus comes for the wedding, riding a white horse. He has a rod in his hand. You'll find it in Psalm 2, verse 9. You'll find also that Jesus Christ is coming, and he's got this sickle in his hand, a shepherd's rod. And you'll find in Revelation 17 and Revelation 18 that it's going to stomp out the great vat there at the Battle of Armageddon. And Christ, Jesus Christ, our blessed bridegroom, King bridegroom, is coming to put an end to Satan's dominance as the god of this age and the prince and the power of the air. Michael's got a chain. He's going to wrap it around old Satan, put him in the jailhouse for 1,000 years, and we're going to rule and reign with Christ here on this earth. So you find that the Lord Jesus Christ here has a name, but he has a nature. Now, when he comes to rule, notice how he rules, not only his name in verse 3, but his nature in verse 4. I can actually read this way in the Hebrew. He comes riding a chariot, Chad, and on this chariot, he has one wheel that's truth, one wheel that's meekness, and one wheel that is righteousness. So he has a three-wheel chariot, and truth is honesty, meekness is humility, and righteousness is holiness. He's coming back to the earth, and he's going to conquer error and lies with truth. And he's going to defeat pride once and for all. Because at the great white throne judgment, even Satan himself will have to admit that he's Lord. So you find that Jesus Christ is a king bridegroom of conquest. One speaks his character of moral glory. This speaks of official glory. Let's move on. Notice his crown. His crown speaks of divine glory. See, I'm not dealing with the word glory here, but it's there. The glory and majesty of Jesus. It's all about glory. And so the Lord Jesus comes in conquest. He comes in character. But notice that he comes with a crown. Verse 6. We know it can't be Solomon. Let's read verse 6. Thy throne, O God, that's a reference to his deity, is forever. So he has an eternal reign. This connects us to 2 Samuel 7. On my flash drive, I have a series of sermons on the covenants and how God made a covenant with David in 2 Samuel chapter 7. And he said to David that out of your lineage and legacy will come one king from Judah, and he will rule and reign in Jerusalem forever and ever and ever. So we have an eternal reign. Secondly, we have a biblical rule. What do you mean biblical rule, preacher? Look at verse number 7. What kind of reign will it be here on earth? How will we reign for eternity? Now, some of you have a Jesus that you've invented that is really not the Jesus of the Bible. Notice what it says about Jesus and his rule. It reveals the essence of who he is in his attributes of hating sin and loving righteousness. Look at verse 7. He will abhor, he will hate wickedness. Now, I'm gonna say this, and I really wanna just emphasize it. I meet so many people that have this Jesus that's a sissy. They act as if Jesus just, you know, never deals with them about their wickedness. I got news for you. He's always gonna deal with you about wickedness in your life. If Jesus Christ lives in you, he hates wickedness. And repentance is you hating what God hates. Now, some of you kind of have listened to this psychological feel-good preaching that says that you ought to not ever beat yourself up and you ought to love yourself. I'll give you an illustration. Paula White, who was instrumental in counseling our former president, made this statement, and I'll quote her verbatim. And if you listen to her, God help you. I'll quote her verbatim. She said, any preacher that teaches you to hate yourself and deny yourself is not preaching the gospel. I'll say to her, anybody who says that you're not to hate yourself and deny yourself does not know the gospel. When Jesus said, except you take up your cross and deny yourself, the best way to translate that is when Jesus comes to bid you to come to him, he's saying that you've got to turn from yourself. MacArthur says that what he means by deny is you've got to hate yourself. People sometimes say things to me when I preach. I travel and preach, and I had a woman walk up to me one time. She said, I don't like you. I said, I don't either. I said, I was so wicked, Jesus had to die for me. I said, also, I was so wicked that I had to be co-crucified with Christ. Well, I shut her up right then, man. She didn't have anything else to say. You know why Bible preaching offends people? Because they have a make-believe Jesus. Leonard Ravenhill says we'll never have revival in the local church and into the Christian's life until you hate what God hates and love what God loves. There has to be a biblical rule. Now, I could go off on our country here, but I'm here to tell you, you need to read a book by Erwin Lutzer, We Will Not Be Silenced. I'm telling you, you need to realize what's happening in the day that we're living. We've been silent about 1% of the people in this country. 1% of the people in this country, the LGBTQ movement, is 1% of this country, and we're letting it rule as 100%. And we've been silent, and we have said that Romans chapter 1 doesn't mean what it says. It means exactly what it says. And I want you to know something. When God created you a man, you don't have to find out whether you're a woman or not. You ought to know whether you're a man by the fact that God created you with certain identifying parts. And so God created women and men differently, distinctly. Now, not one's better than the other, but we function differently. Some of you ladies have far more water than us men. And I know when you have a baby now, you don't not to talk about breastfeeding, it's chest feeding. But listen, we're living in a stupid day. And everybody quotes science. Listen, you need to hate wickedness and love righteousness. There needs to be what? Eternal reign, biblical rule, but joyful restoration. Look at the last part of verse number 7. In verse 7, it says that Jesus Christ will be anointed with the oil of gladness above thy fellows. I don't know how to tell you, but Jesus forfeited the joy of heaven when he came here to the earth. What do you mean the joy of heaven he forfeited? He forfeited angels and everything in heaven worshiping him. Let me tell you what Christmas was for Jesus. For you, it was salvation, but for him, it was suffering. And for him, he would experience something he had never experienced, and that would be that God the Father and God the Holy Spirit would forsake him and leave him alone. Let me go to my next point. Notice the clothing of our king bridegroom. Now, is it not important what you wear at a wedding? Well, according to Revelation 19, you're going to wear to your wedding what's in your hope chest. And I don't have time to preach about this, but you're going to wear what has been put in your hope chest by the Holy Spirit, motivated by love for the glory of God. And you'll be given that at the Bema seat, and you'll wear that for eternity. And so you actually are responsible for your own outward garment that you will wear. And it's called in Revelation 19, the righteous acts of saints, which means that you will wear what you've allowed Jesus to accomplish through you from regeneration, either to your death or to the rapture. But notice his clothing. Look at verse 8. He smells of what? Myrrh, aloes, and cassia. You'll find all three of these were something to do with three things. First of all, some of these were used in his incarnation. They were given to him at his birth by the wise men. Then you'll find that some of these were given to him at his crucifixion, when his death. And so when you smell his clothes, get close to, no, because of COVID, don't, but smell yourself. Now, some of you got on some pretty good perfume. Some of you need help. But anyway, you know, we just smell. You know how I can tell sometimes when I work all day that I need to take a bath? I smell myself. And it's not good. But I didn't mention this in the first service, Chad. But this that is mentioned here was used to be crushed to make the anointing oil for the prophet, priest, and king. Lastly, and I'll close, I want to talk to you about his church. Beginning at verse 9, we quit talking about the bridegroom and we talk about the bride. You'll find in verse 11 that he says that you're beautiful. Now, why are you beautiful? Because he lives in you. You have moral glory. Now you're sinless because you've been made perfect. You don't have this Adamic nature anymore. The rapture, you got rid of it. And you've been clothed. And now you are beautiful. But there's two things I want you to see that identifies those of us who make up the church. And the individual Christians, yes. And the emphasis in most preachers' preaching is an individual personal relationship with Jesus, and it should be. But listen carefully. The church is really those who've been born again from Pentecost to the rapture. And we're called the bride of Jesus. Old Testament saints, not part of the bride. Jesus said that John the Baptist wasn't part of the bride. The Old Testament saints are not even resurrected at the rapture. They're resurrected in Revelation 20, verse 4, at the beginning of the millennium. The tribulation saints are not part of the church. They're resurrected after the tribulation period. We are the church of the living God. And the church is the beautiful bride of Jesus. I want you to see two things about the church. Now, how many of you would say, preacher, I'm a Christian and I'm part of this bride? Raise your hand. Okay. These two things are not true about you. You just lied. Now, is it possible for you to be deceived? Is it possible for you to think because you made a profession of faith that you really belong to Jesus? Is it possible for you to believe that you truly are one of His and you're not one of His? It is. So these two things are true about you. First of all, would you look at verse 11? Here's the first one. So shall the king greatly desire thy beauty. Now, what is your beauty? For he is thy Lord. Now, here's the reason some of you told a story. It's because you think he can be your Savior and take you to heaven and not be the Lord of your heart and the lover of your soul right now. Much debate among those who preach whether when a person comes to Jesus, must they surrender as much as they know about themselves to the Lord Jesus Christ, and can you have your sins forgiven, accept Him as your Savior, and then later make Him Lord? Number one, you don't make Him anything. Number two, if He comes to live inside of you, He is Lord. That's who He is. And so you can't invite Him to come live in you and then separate Himself from Himself. So you can't say, Jesus, I want you to be my Savior, and then later I want you to be my Lord. Let me illustrate. I was preaching in Cincinnati. There's a preacher up there. His wife has ovarian cancer. She's going through a very difficult time. Johnny Hunt tapped me and asked me if I would go up there and preach for them. I think it was the Sunday before Christmas. And I flew into Cincinnati, and I preached up there in two services. And after the second service, this lady approached me after the service, and here's what she said. She was very much, it looked like, under conviction. She said to me, she said, preacher, after hearing you preach this morning, I want to ask you a question. She said, I met Jesus Christ as my Savior when I was a child. But I'm now in my 50s. And then she made this statement. He's never, ever, ever been my Lord. And after hearing you preach this morning, I'd like for Him to be my Lord. I said, well, let me follow it up with a question. What would make you think that you were ever saved as a child, and He's never been your Lord, and now you say that you're saved, but you want Him as Lord? I said, you've never been saved. Now, the associate pastor stand right beside me. She said, well, I believe I was saved. I said, no, you weren't. I said, go home and read 1 John. And when you get lost and realize you've never been saved, God will save you. You said, boy, that is judgmental, that is hard, and that's harsh. No, it's the truth. If a person says that they've never known Jesus Christ as Lord, and they have fire insurance, and they know that they're going to die and go to heaven, that's deception, that's a lie out of the pit of hell, and Jesus Christ does not offer salvation without you being willing to receive Him as Lord. Ask the rich young ruler. We have filled our churches with people that have never truly been saved on God's terms. Lordship is not optional. It's who he is. What's the indication that you know lordship? Look at verse 10. Hearken, incline, leave your family. I didn't say that. That's what the psalmist said. Anybody who's going to attend this wedding, anybody who's going to be married to this Jesus, is a person that hearkens, inclines, listens, obeys, submits, surrenders. Lordship is not optional. Now, the associate pastor said to me, he said, why didn't you just try to help her right here? I said, because she's not lost yet. See, I used to think the only thing you needed to know to be saved is that you were a sinner. No, you got to know two other things to be saved. You got to know not only that you're a sinner, but you need to know that you're lost. Jesus came to seek and to save those who are lost. You know why some of you are not saved? Because you don't see yourself as lost. You don't see yourself as perishing. You don't see yourself as going to hell. You don't see yourself as a person that is a child of darkness. You don't see yourself as depraved. You don't realize that you're offensive. You don't realize that you've broken God's law. You don't understand that you've offended God by just being born. You're a sinner by nature. And then thirdly, you have to know in order to be saved that you can't save yourself. Look at verse 11. He's thy Lord, and what do you do because he's your Lord? You worship. There's a church up in Rutherfordton. Anybody ever been to Rutherfordton? It's a church up in the mountains in Rutherfordton. And I preached Psalm 2 there years and years and years ago. And this old man in the church, every time I've gone back since then, and I usually go back there every 18 months and do a meeting. This old man, here's what he does, Chad. Every time I preach, he comes down the aisle and he gets in the altar. He gets in the altar. So one of the Sundays I was up there preaching in meeting, I said to him as he went out, I said, why is it that you come to the altar every service? He said, because you preached Psalm 2 here at this church years ago, and you said that worship is bowing and kissing Jesus. And he said, I am not going to miss out on a chance to get me some sugar. He said, I'm going to kiss Jesus till I die. I'll close with this. 10-year-old boy, his name was William. He was born in England. At the age of 10, he went blind. All of a sudden, he just couldn't see. He was a very bright young man. And so therefore he went off to school, and he was an honor student. He was very, very good as far as his education, had a good personality, and he got a scholarship to the number one graduate school in England. And when he got there, he met a girl. Now, this girl that he met, her daddy was an admiral in the British Army. Now, he was from an aristocrat himself, and he was a young man at this time, and he met her and he fell in love with her. Amazing, she fell in love with him. Let me tell you what happened. She fell in love with him, and he asked her to marry him. The British admiral went to a surgeon who had perfected a surgery at that time when they would tear out some of the tissue in the eye, and he said, I believe I can enable this young man to see. And so the young man said, I want to have the surgery right before my wedding. So he had the surgery. He agreed to it. His dad was standing beside of him when his bride started down the aisle. His dad started removing the gauze from his eyes. He blinked his eyes and he said, I can see. Tears came to his eyes. She was standing right beside him to be married. And he looked at her and he said, oh, I waited to see because you're the one I want to see. And you're more beautiful than I ever dreamed. Oh, my Jesus. I shall look into your face, the one who saved me by his grace. You're beautiful, more beautiful than I ever imagined. You're beautiful in forgiveness. You're beautiful in atonement. You're beautiful in your sinless character. You're beautiful. You were with me in my trials. You wipe away my tears. You're precious. More precious than I ever, ever imagined. I attended all my children's weddings. I wouldn't have missed them. But out of all the weddings that I'll ever attend, please don't miss this. Lordship. Worship. If you don't worship him here, you won't worship him there. Let's stand together. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed, we have our time of appeal, invitation. Maybe some of you just need to come to the altar today and kiss the Son, bow to his lordship. I wonder if there's one here would say, preacher, pray for me, I'm lost. God showed me this morning that I've never truly repented and received him as my Lord and Savior. and I need Jesus today. If that's your condition, would you lift your hand? I'll pray for you. I promise you, I will not embarrass you. But if you know you're lost, why don't you admit it? I want to pray for you right now. Chad's here at the front. Staff is here. Jesus died publicly for you. Why don't you come and receive him publicly? And some of you are going to be married to Jesus, but you're not where you need to be with the Lord this morning. You need to repent. Some of you are in the balcony. Why don't you slip out and come right now? Heavenly Father, give us grace right now to come. In Jesus' name, amen.